often to do this. Bonsoir, Montréal. Welcome, everybody. So, my name is Vlada Stamenkovic. I'm from the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And let me ask you first how you feel. Warm? Good? Well, let's do a thought experiment. Let's go out together. The way you are right now. It's a bit cold, right? And I'm from Southern California. For me, it's quite cold. So let's go out. We put all the, you know, the warming effects of sheep that we can have, put it around us. And let's do a thought experiment. Let's reduce the temperature to about minus 60 degrees Celsius. Still feeling good? Let's have some swings going down to minus 130 degrees Celsius. Well, a little bit more chilly now, huh? Let's change the atmosphere and throw in all CO2. Then let's reduce the pressure by about a factor of 160 to about 6 millibar. How are we feeling now? Let's stop this. Let's bathe in wonderful ionizing radiation, UV, and in really strong oxidants. So what I can say right now is welcome to Mars. To be precise, welcome to the Martian surface. Now, the interesting thing is, we knew that already, actually, that the Martian surface is maybe in some ways quite inhospitable to life, as my doctor says, because of its conditions. We knew that already in 1976, when we had Viking 1 and Viking 2, two landers, landing on Mars. However, at that time, people thought, oh, well, the surface is really bad for life, so there is no life anywhere on Mars, right? That's the conclusion. However, at that time, we didn't know one thing. We didn't know what's happening beneath our own feet, here on the Earth. Let's continue our thought experiment. What do you see around you? Look around. Just be frank. Look around. Try it. Come on. You see people. You know, you see trees. You see lamps. You see, you know, your neighbors sometimes, if you have to. So you see all life that you experience. All life we know is happening on the surface, right? I call it the surface boundary layer phenomenon. But as many times, you know, we live in a little bubble, socially, but also from our understanding. And when we live in a little bubble, we often lack a deeper understanding of everything around us. And in my context, deeper has not just a metaphoric meaning, but actual literal meaning. Because what we lack is the understanding what's beneath our feet. There's not just a dead ball of rock beneath us. There's a huge, vast volume of rock and water, liquid water. Those together create nutrients, create hydrogen, methane, things that bugs eat. They create life in the deep subsurface. Wherever we drill, kilometers deep, here in Canadian Shields or in South Africa, we find life. It's not as Jules Verne imagined it, you know, big and interesting. It's still interesting, but not big. It's mostly microbes. They live slowly. There's not many of them, but they're there. And they thrive in the deep grounds. So that's what we're trying to do with actually Earth 4D in the CIFAR program. We're exploring life under our feet and resources, volatiles, and trying to understand what the subsurface bears to understand life beyond the Earth and for our own society. So, but what does it mean now for Mars? Well, it means that there might be actually life hiding in the Martian deep subsurface at similar depths of a few kilometers where liquid water could exist on Mars today. It's plausible, it's possible it's there. Honestly, we don't know because we haven't really explored it yet. We don't have the data, and data rules at the end. So, is there something we can do about this? Yes, we can, and we're doing something about that. By the way, yes, we can is a good slogan, remember that. So, what we're doing right now, actually, at JPL, is we've been developing an instrument for the last 2 years, and I've been very fortunate to lead those efforts. The instrument is called THOR, T-H-2-O-R. It stands for Transmissive H2O Reconnaissance. And what it does is it uses electromagnetic waves in order to sound liquid water at large depths. And by not just finding out if there is liquid water, we also try to find out what this water is made of, what its chemistry is. And that's really important, because once you understand there is liquid water in the ground and what its chemistry is, then we can start to think what kind of life could be there and whether life could be there. And that's the next step that we have to take. Now, wonderful. So, you know, we see now maybe there's life in the Martian subsurface. We have a way to explore it. We have an instrument developing for this. But what does it mean for us? here on the earth? Well, in one hand, you know, I think it's quite awesome. That's a very American word, but, you know, there we go, Southern California. It's really, I think, very awesome to think about if there is life out there. I do believe and think that if we find evidence of life somewhere else, that it will very profoundly affect our life here on the world, even if we find no evidence. It will change us in many ways. It will hopefully make us more humble and ground us more, and at the same time make us a bit more noble to see beyond, to explore. So we could just stop here. However, we have problems on our own planet that's a much more, you know, grounded problems. And it's called thirst. And I'm not talking about the thirst for that, you know, delicious cocktail or the second cup of decaf latte macchiato, which is, of course, legit. But I'm talking about real thirst. People on this planet, near and far, near as well, are actually thirsty. They don't have access to clean drinking water. And that's a big problem because, you know, we all like water. It's essential for life as we know it. So what we're doing is by developing an instrument that's going to search for liquid water in the Martian subsurface, we're also developing a very simple tool that's not as advanced as all the really great instruments that we have already on our planet to search for water. But it's much cheaper, much simpler, and it can be, you know, you can use small smartphone apps, that means any kid can use it, to actually explore if there is liquid water, drinkable liquid water, in your vicinity. And what we're trying to do is, on one hand, you know, search for signs of life on Mars and beyond, and use the same technology to help our communities here in the world to have access to drinking water and survive. You know, right now, we're at a spot where we can actually access some really important knowledge. We can go to Mars, we can search for signs of life, and maybe it's too late for David Bowie, who asked the question, is there life on Mars, to hear the answer, but it's not too late for us. We can find out if there is actually life in the Martian subsurface in the next decade. And we can also use that technology to help people here on the planet find water and survive. And combining, therefore, how to survive Mars to surviving here on our own planet. And together, elevate surviving to actually living. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.